Sarah will now try to find Zoe, her persona friend, and she will not be able to. This is because her persona has already been dissolved or integrated in the in the Jungian process of individuation. At night, Sarah will confront Jeremy at the hospital entrance with the following dialogue.
Hey, nerd. Hey. What were those pictures Anita showed me this morning? I can't tell you that. I'm not coming back till you do. So you're not quitting? I won't quit or tell anyone you were stalking me.
If
you tell me what you're studying.
It's not happening.
Please. It's starting to get skipped, okay? Ever since this morning, it's... I have never felt so weird.
But if I show you, it could completely compromise the results.
Listen to me. I think your science project is fucking me up. If I leave, doesn't that compromise your results?
The blackmail will work, and Jeremy will show Sarah what they're doing. This is akin, or is the same, is a reflection of the coma dream subconscious, okay, the shadow realizing they might have some input from the outside, in my opinion, okay. Then Jeremy will show her the dream of someone else. Let's analyze this dream. In order to understand this dream, we have to remind ourselves first that everything that happens is inside the head of Sarah. Thus, when her mind is inventing the dream of someone else, it cannot avoid being the mind of Sarah. We see first some deaths from a hospital ward, which can suggest her shadow, her personal unconscious, is starting to comprehend the situation. We have a hand showing us a neck, which can mean a lot of things, but I believe in this case it means an unhatched potential, a new life which might be opening. Okay. In the same way Jeremy is watching Sarah dream, they have been watched while the whole collective of characters in coma Sarah perform their dream. Okay. Then we see some upside down characters, which can be either part of the integration of the collective unconscious or the fierce appearance of the doctors, which I don't think it is. Some icons left and right, which form some sort of bridge, which might refer to the outside doctors, and some children's toys, which might reiterate again the sense of new beginning. And finally, the icon appears this time on the left side. This, in my opinion, is because if the mind is inventing a dream of someone else, the inevitable icon will not appear in front, as there isn't really any someone else there. Okay? So let's recall when we are. When Sarah, the ego, is dreaming about the ego, the icon figure is looking ahead, so we look at their back. When we're confronting parts of her personality or her mind, the persona, the shadow, we have an icon looking at us because they're confronting someone inside. But when the dream is about a third party, well, the shadow, another part of the Sarah's mind, the icon will appear on one side. This is a dream within the common dream of the shadow, not the ego. Okay? Reminding again that the shadow is as much part of the person as the ego is. Another interpretation is that at that point, the icon is the first break of a doctor from outside. But I don't think so, as I think the doctors are differentiated from the part of Sarah's mind by the glowing light. Okay. This is a dream of the shadow, and that's why Jeremy, who is the shadow, is showing that to the ego, to Sarah. When Sarah tells Jeremy that they shouldn't be doing that, Jeremy says,
"This is nuts." Don't you ever feel like you're seeing something that you're not supposed to? I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't have a reason, Sarah. Which is...
But conveniently, the train of thought gets interrupted. Too conveniently. Sarah rejoins the study, and we go to the title of The Shadow. So now we know we'll focus on the shadow. Sarah, the ego, will now dream about the shadow. And the dream is as follows. We're not in a cave now. We start in some sort of void with debris of matter which form face broken in pieces, and we go inside. So we're going beyond the ego and the persona. We're going down deep through a staircase and then a manhole, and we confront the shadow. The shadow is a part of our a personal unconscious. These are the unconscious that we have created in our own life. It's not the shadow of the archetypes we've inherited biologically or culturally from our ancestry or our culture, but that we've buried within us in our own life. And the scientists outside that are looking at our dream from outside see that coma that Sarah is confronting. Her unconscious, her shadow. That is a reflection of the scientists or the doctors outside watching the dream of coma Sarah. Then what happens is that Sarah, the ego, cannot take the stress and wakes up. In the same way, we wake up when we have some nightmare. And that will be useful later on. When Anita looks at the camera after having gone to her and saying, Sarah, how are you? There's a moment in which she looks at the camera and represents when she's looking at Jeremy, realizing that Sarah, I know, this might signify the doctors outside know the shadow of comma Sarah is reachable. We see Sarah's eye hurt. The attempt to integrate the shadow is at the moment unsuccessful. She cannot confront her shadow. It is too hard. Then Sarah's ego escapes. Where? Well, she escapes the opposite of the shadow, the opposite of deepness, introspection. She goes looking for the persona. But she cannot find it. That's because she's already individuated and dissolving and has dissolved the persona. At the same time, we see Jeremy, the shadow, looking for her. She herself knows the shadow needs to be individuated, and the shadow in her coma dream knows as well, therefore. And thus, this shadow, Jeremy, is looking actively for the ego. And we see Dr. Mike going to the office and learning what happened and the scene in which we see the unconscious, the animals have some sleeping terrors. Those are, in my opinion, the doctors outside trying to reach Sarah via the unconscious, via her animus in this case. It's another piece of the mind that they can attempt to reach. This fails and everything breaks down. And we have basically the doctors watching outside this strategy and how is it a catastrophe. And that represents the doctors outside Commissara also realizing that this attempt has failed, basically. The sleep clinicians in the dream opening the door is the reflection of the doctors outside stopping. Next stop is the self. We have our title of the self. And now we'll see the last stage of the film and the last stage of the individuation process. So just to recap, we have the integration of the persona, the integration of the animus, and the shadow, which is not completely integrated, but it will, when it will be completely integrated, will go to the self. In the dream, we see a bunch of characters. We have some leftover mannequins, which might mean a bunch of already integrated parts, or, you know, like a collective unconscious kind of integrated part. We go through a door, as always, but in this case it's a concrete wall, through the inside of closing beast, which I believe it's the shadow, because it's not completely integrated yet. We reach a small door in a small structure with an orthodox cross and some candles, which might indicate we're entering the sacred. Inside there's a church-like edifice with an icon that's not like the shadow or the icons that we've seen before, but this time it's a kind of Greek-like statue, rather positive image with plenty of lines, which I believe are connections maybe to other parts, okay? Maybe those other parts mean the outside. Some contacts have been already established. And we finally reach an icon with glowing eyes, which I think means the doctors outside are able to read them by, and they're basically, it's already reflecting in the dreams, within dreams, that this contact is acknowledged in her subconscious. Okay. And finally, we have numerous petrified figures, which I think they are like the integrated parts, right? Trying to reach that icon. Sarah wakes up at Jeremy's house and she finds some covert machines, and it finds that Jeremy is sleeping and monitoring himself, which foretells what will happen. The sleep analysis by Sarah's ego. That's what will happen. So Sarah will now watch Jeremy dream. We have a part in which the ego sees in that dream of Jeremy the willingness of the shadow to integrate with the ego and thus to create the self. In the vision of Jeremy, in the video of Jeremy, in which it is shown the last of Jeremy for Sarah. And we see also the specific form of the shadow, because shadow is a repressed part. So there has to be something repressed, and these repairs, the form that it takes, this repressed part, in this case, is a vampire fantasy. Okay. Next, we have the sleeping terror by Jeremy. Okay, so Jeremy has like a sleeping terror while while at the end of his dream. Again, another failed attempt to connect from the outside. And this also fails because it's stopped by the ego, by Sarah. Okay. Very, very, she gets freaked out and she just stops it, which is what will happen, what would happen normally. Yeah. If your ego, if you find somebody trying to connect with your unconscious, exactly, it's exactly what you would do. They stop for a coffee. And we have this image in which we see Jeremy looking at Sarah. It's worth to look at their facial expressions, looking at her like very sternly, and she's looking like, oh. And she basically discovers in the bathroom, she discovers that her eye is okay now. So the fear and the pain of confronting the shadow is gone. And she's ready for it. She's ready for integrating the shadow, which will be a sexual process. Okay. Now will be the time in which the ego will take the offer by asking to spend the night at his. Okay, and then the conversation that they have in the car. Now we'll move to the sex scene, and it's important to understand what's happening here. As I understand it, what's going on is the following. We see that they're being monitored by the doctors while they're having sex, because we see these shadows on the room, okay, in this integration process of the ego and the shadow, and thus becoming the self. Also, what's happening here is that they enter into a dream within a dream. So the whole end of the movie until she will wake up again is within the process of having sex, and when in the climax, or in the moment in which she loses consciousness, right until the end. Everything that will happen will be within this integration process. That is my belief. And they'll be monitored, okay, in this process. And what happens then is that we are in a level of dreams in which you got your base coma dream of Sarah, in which the ego is the protagonist most of the time. And then we'll have another level, which would be like a dream within a dream, but in this case will not be the ego dreaming in black and white as the author of the movie dreams. That's why he does dreams as they are. But will be a full-colored dream, and will be protagonized mainly by the shadow, by Jeremy in this case. Okay, Sarah will be just there walking, sleepwalking, which would be it's a representation of coma dream, the coma dream that is underneath the current representation. We start this new phase by another dream, okay? And this is the dream of the self being acted now by Jeremy. We see an icon of wood being dismantled. This is the integration of the shadow. That the shadow is being integrated in this precise moment. We hear a telephone call. That would represent the doctors outside. We see a figure on the right hand side, which is like the signal reaching inside. We see a statue, a phone, a door opening, and the final icon, the self. And finally, through a hospital like space, we see a terror figure. And we'll see why we need a terror figure later in the conversation between Jeremy acting as the shadow and Nietzsche, which is the reflection of the knowledge or the acknowledgement that there's an outside party there. We have a Jeremy trying to find the ego, Sarah, in the hospital. There's a 237 room reference from The Shining, right? And we'll find Sarah walking at the parking. Jeremy will call Anita, and which this is the shadow, the unconscious, calling the acknowledgement that an outside party exists, okay? And we'll have also our Sarah dreaming, okay? Our level one, if you will, dream represented there. So the comma Sarah dreaming is the first level, and then we have the second one within our integration process. There's actually a moment in which Jeremy asks Anita to please try it again. Let's try, do me this favor. Let's try that one more time, or let's try that, because I think that now it's gonna work. And Anita says, okay, last time, and we're done, because we you know, have enough of that. Okay, so we progress. They do the whole walking. We see that's clearly a dream, okay? Even if it's the first time that you watch the movie and you don't know anything about it, you can see that she's walking barefooted at one point, and then she has some very easy to see duck sleepers, okay? So they are like big and ridiculous, so that you notice that she has it. That's so you realize at this moment that this is a dream, even if you don't know anything about the movie, it's the first time you watch it. And we already know where we are, okay? Then they're looking at the dream of Sarah. So they have brought the whole machine, like a mobile version of the tools that they have in the sleep clinic, and they're watching Sarah. So if Sarah is the dream in which thereupon, so their level of reality, their dream is upon Sarah, and Sarah in that dream is representing the level underneath. So if they're watching her dream, they're in reality they're watching themselves. That's why in this time, what they will see, what the observer will see in the screen while they watch Sarah, is exactly what's happening to them. And that's why it's matching. It's becoming true what they see in the screen. It's what's happening to them right now. Even at the end, when they see the whole bunch of icons, they see that there's a parallelism between what they're watching on the screen and their own reality. Okay, so let's hear the conversation.
Why don't we take her back to the hospital?
Because she's not safe there. They have no clue what's happening to her, no more than we do. What's up? good. You can help us get her out. You keep watch.
So this is the intention, and that's what's happening, and that's why you need the terror element. Because Jeremy, the unconscious, knows that in order to wake up the ego, Sarah, from this second dream, but especially also from the first dream, they will need a terror element, because when you have a nightmare, you tend to wake up. Okay, he needs to turn the coma dream, the basic coma dream, into a terror dream, into a nightmare, so that she will wake up. Okay, so this is foretelling what's going to happen in real life. It's not really real life. It's just a coma dream, but that's what's happening. Then we see the terror figures, which are those icons which we see on each side of the screen. Not in front, looking at us, like we've seen normally, but they are outside and they have like glowing eyes. So we know it's there, the doctors outside. They're looking at this process, okay? And there's a bunch of them. So there is expectation about that, okay? At the same time, those terror figures are reflected in the screen, in outside. We'll see them, and also reflect also what the doctors outside in the real world, looking at the whole process. Okay, and at the end we see Sarah entering a building with light inside, with a light door, a representation of the telephone call they receive. If you look at it, if you carefully, you'll see that it's exactly the same moment in which she sees on the screen the white light, the white door, that the telephone call is happening. Okay, and that is a representation of, again, telephone mobile phone. This is communication. Okay, so there, it's a representation of the transmission of the message. Here is where we have the actual real connection, the success, in which the doctors outside, rather than presenting themselves, they left a voicemail, if you will, or a text message. Okay. Jeremy picks up the phone. So Jeremy's picking up this message. Okay. And then they go back through the forest. Nita has this weird look, looking at them. We have a small conversation about the phone, and they receive on the phone number 101, which apparently spiritually means that you're going to go through a soul awakening very soon. Okay, new beginnings and personal development. Yeah, so that's pretty much what's going to happen now. And then basically they see the figures, they get scared because they don't know what they are, and they start to run, and they start to disappear. Anita disappears, Jerry disappears. Now, if you don't know what this is, you may think this is some monsters taking them out. But if you look at them, there's nothing gruesome or anything like that. They're not being caught. They're literally disappearing. So this is basically her mind ending a dream. So in the way we our mind works, no energy will be wasted for something that it's not necessary anything anymore. So when the dream is closing, those elements disappear until she's in the void, pretty much, okay. And then we'll see figure, a final icon. When they see this final icon, I do not think that this is the a doctor. I think that this is the end of the process of integration. So this final icon is the self. Now, this is a matter of opinion. At the beginning of the scene, it looks like the eyes are glowing, which would tell you, in my theory, that these are a doctor from outside. But when the camera focuses, you see that his eyes are not glowing. It's basically a reflection of some light from outside. So this is the self, and as we have seen in all different representations in our dreams, at the end you're confronting with something, and we see that this face is a bit more feminine, I would say. So I believe that this is the self, the final process, the perfect individuated person, if you will, in Jungian terms. Then Sarah awakes from that shadow dream, we could say, okay, and she finds herself on top of Jeremy, and she's being basically she has gouged his eyes basically. Now this is very gruesome, but again, I think that when you know the significance of this, it's pretty much that she's alone. The ego now has integrated the persona, the animus, and the shadow. Jeremy is within her, if you will. Okay. Now she is the only character, the self. Okay. She walks a bit alien-like, if you will, to the bathroom, and she reads the message before us. And as a consequence of reading that message, she looks at the mirror and sees that she has some fangs, okay, having incorporated the shadow, and thus this terror element, okay, and because she's checking out that, yeah, she has incorporated her own shadow, and therefore she has finished the Jungian process. She realized that there's an outside party because, and that's the last scene of the movie, because the message from the doctors outside has actually reached her mobile phone, her found again mobile phone, which, remember, she didn't find. So she, in dream one, or at dream level one, coma dream one, there's no point in which she found her mobile phone. That happened in level two, but whenever it's convenient, her mind makes the phone appear in the same way that her mind made the phone disappear. Okay, so conveniently, since there's something to communicate, a phone appears, and it has the final message of the movie, which reveals the whole thing. And now we can deduce from that she will wake up, because we are at level one dream with a terror element, nightmare element, that will make her wake up. This movie is amazing. The director merits all the praise for it. Anthony Scott Burns, I think that he did some other film, but this is his own, the one that's the first one that's of his own making and his own signing, and that he did what he wanted to do, and plus he did a lot of it, effects, script, everything, and this very good. I mean, it's hard to find good scripts. It's hard to find good. It's a bit of a gem. Okay, I hope He gets all the financing for whatever other project Mr. Scott Burns has in mind, because it's definitely, and also he has a very cheap way of filming, so that's a plus for him, because I think that if you have good ideas and good actors, you don't need big budgets. There's plenty of movies that are my favorites that which are basically opera primas sometimes, which are based on good scripts and good actors. You don't need much fancier things. Very well done, come true by Anthony Scott Burns, and very original as well. A mixing of themes, which is very, very well tied together. The whole sleep clinic thing is a world on itself. And I'll see you next time.